We, the members of the Concord Fortress of Hope Church, trust and believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We are commissioned to teach and preach Christ to the hurting, needy, and disenfranchised in the Ruskin-Hickman Mills area and its surrounding communities, and are committed to raising the spiritual and physical standards of living of all we touch through the power of the Holy Spirit, trusting in the Lord with all our hearts and all our ways, acknowledging Him as He directs our paths.
Concord, good morning. Thank you for joining us. Hey, visitors, listen, if you could take 2 seconds and just click the link below and fill it out, we would love to hear from you. Listen, I don't know about you all, but I'm ready for church this morning. Y'all have a great day. Enjoy the service.
Connected Sunday. We want to make sure that all of our members are on the same page and on one accord and know what's going on in the life of our church. If you have not liked our Facebook page, put in Concord Fortress of Hope Church and like the Facebook page. Here's why. We stream service every Sunday at 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. and it's live. And when you like the Facebook page, you're notified of that. But if you're someone to say, hey, I don't like Facebook, that's not my thing, that's okay. We're available on YouTube as well. Put in Concord Fortress of Hope Church, subscribe to the YouTube page, and you'll be notified whenever we go live. Two simple ways to be aware of what's going on in the life of our church. Also, Wednesday night Bible study is streamed live on Facebook. Another reason for you to like the Facebook page, and that's at 6:30 p.m. every Wednesday night. The last way you can be connected, and probably one of the biggest ways, and stay in the know of what's going on at our church, is our text message system. If you've not been put into the text message system, you're not automatically put into it. You have to actually subscribe to it. And this is how you do it. You text the word member to the number. And once you text the word member, it will literally drop you into the system and you'll be notified whenever we send a text message out. And you can also even text in questions and concerns that you have yourself. So Concord, those are simple ways that we can be connected. So let's get on one accord for the Lord this Sunday.
Yeah. Good morning. I hope you're enjoying worship. Today we're going to be dealing with a text that really talks about how God shows up in the midst of fear. How in the midst of our anxiety, even depression, God can be glorified not because of us, but because of who he is. Go with me quickly to Judges, the 6th chapter, starting with the 11th verse, and it reads, "Now the angel of the Lord sat under the terebinth tree, which was in Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, while his son Gideon thrashed wheat in the winepress in order to hide from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, 'The Lord is with you, mighty man of valor.' Gideon said to him, 'Oh, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his miracles, which our fathers told us about, saying, did not the Lord bring us out of Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites.' And the Lord turned to him and said, 'Go into this you mighty one, and you shall save Israel from the hands of the Midianites. Have I not sent you?' So he said to him, 'Oh, my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house.' And the Lord said to him, 'Surely I'll be with you, and you shall defeat the Midianites as one man.'" What a wonderful passage this is. It really takes off, and its life is in a book that is the most, or seems to be the most uneventful and the most boring of all of the books in the Bible, the book of Judges. It shares the same story over and over and over, where God blesses his people. His people sin against him. He sends a deliverer, and their lives get better. God blesses them. They sin against God. God sends a deliverer. Their lives get better. Over and over and over and over. Isn't it interesting that life really doesn't change for any of us? If we look back through the course of history, the events of mankind really never change. Empires come, empires go. God blesses. People sin against him. God blesses again. It is the course of history. That's why, brothers and sisters, never get so dreary and down to believe that God really isn't active in the affairs of our nation and in the affairs of people. God is always active, visible. Even as we sin against him, he allows events to happen and things to happen. But he ultimately comes and he rescues his people. It is the course of what life is. It is the course of what Gideon is experiencing. Their nation has been taken advantage of. The Midianites have taken control of the nations because of Israel's sin against God. And fear has become pervasive in the land so much that their activities and how they carried out their duties have shifted. They became afraid because their concerns that the Midianites would take their food and leave them with nothing and kill them. And look at what Gideon does. He moves the food from the outside into a space that was not created for that. He moves it into the space where the wine press is. Wine is interesting because during this time, wine was as much medicinal than anything else. It was used to help calm stomachs. It was used in ways that helped the standard of life for people, to help them digest, to help them with eating. And so now they bring the food from the outside on the inside where this medicine, this wine was being created. It's funny, and we have to be careful. Don't ever lose sight that God knows your fears and your anguish. He even knows the why you make the decisions that you make out of fear. I hope you get this point today. That he knows the tensions around the what it is that this moment is creating in you. Gideon is afraid. He moves inside and he begins to thrash, to separate, to beat the wheat in this space that was meant to really press wine. Brothers and sisters, just know that God knows your fears. He knows why you're making some of the decisions that you're making. He understands the fear of why America is making some of the decisions that we're making. He understands the worries, even get this, y'all, in the faith community, why we're making some bad decisions around some issues that are exceedingly important, that are tremendously important. He understands it, but I also want you to know that he is still there and ever present. So why, in the midst of Gideon in the wine press, thrashing wheat, the angel of the Lord appears. Now, whenever you see the angel of the Lord in the Old Testament, it is the pre-incarnate work in salvation and deliverance of Jesus. So whenever I hear people talk about that Jesus never was active in the Old Testament, brothers and sisters, when you see the angel of the Lord, it is the work of Jesus in the Old Testament. And now the Father has dispatched the angel of the Lord to go to this fragile and broken young man. And he calls him this. He says, "Mighty man of valor." Now, when we look at the Hebrew, when we see this phrase, it is a redundant phrase. It is a repeat in the phrase. It is mighty man, mighty man. It is not one phrase like we see in the Old Testament in English. It is mighty man, mighty man. It is God reinforcing through the words of his son, through being the angel of the Lord, he is reinforcing to this young man's fears and trepidations. He is reinforcing, you are more than what you think you are. What an amazing word today. That in this, God reinforces something that Gideon never saw himself as at all. A matter of fact, Gideon says he is the least among the children of Manasseh. He is the least among those that are born out of that tribe. That he has the least influence. He has the least might. But brothers and sisters, the power of this text is, watch this, that God sees more in us than what we see in us. Isn't that good? God really does know more about you than what you know. God understands parts of you that you do not understand. He calls him mighty man of valor. Brothers and sisters, you need to understand that God really does know you. And God knows what you're capable of. Even when you don't believe that you're capable in and of yourself, God knows the power within you. And so he has to reinforce that. So the angel of the Lord comes and he reinforces to this fragile, intellectual young man who is under siege, whose culture is under siege by a foreign force. And he says, you're more than who you think you are. You are a mighty, mighty man. And I'm talking to people of the faith right now. That some of you are giving up and some of you have quit and some of you are so worried. Don't you dare believe that God doesn't know how worried you are. He absolutely knows how worried you are. But he also knows more about you than you know about yourself. You know, a lot of us now are on social media. And whether it be Facebook, whether it be any of those other platforms, all of those platforms now have come up with this thing that's called a filter. And filters are these things that make you look better than what you really might look. They can put stars above your head. They can make your smile look prettier. They can put these wonderful phrases around your name and just really make you look better than what you really, really look. Brothers and sisters, in a spiritual way, God, in the work of Jesus, has done the same thing. Said, no, that's not true. Yes, it is. When you get a chance, look at 1 Peter, the 4th chapter, in the 8th verse. And it talks about the work of the blood of Jesus. Because of the work of Jesus and his shed blood, now we come before God, not in our sin, not in our shortcomings, but really covered by the blood of Jesus. And now he makes intercession for us through his work. And so when God sees us, he does not see our sin. He sees the wonder of the work of his son. Brothers and sisters, how many of you are really glad that you, God, through the blood of Jesus, has put a filter over your life? That is the wonderful part of this text. That's the wonderful part of this passage, that as frail and feeble as Gideon thought he was, Jesus saw more in him. God saw more in him than he saw in himself. That's why I get so excited when moments like this come and I see people who really have been marginalized step up and are transformative. And God uses them in ways that they never thought they'd be used. Second part of this is this, that the angel of the Lord said this to him, that God is with you. Gideon is absolutely tripping, y'all. He is absolutely tripping. But God has to let him know that he is with him. And this is how we know that Gideon is tripping, because he goes into this rant about the forefathers told us that God delivered us out of Egypt. And now that he's delivered us out of Egypt, we're not experiencing the wonders and the miracles. Where are the miracles that God shared? Where is the brilliant work of God that he shared when he delivered his people out of bondage in Egypt? How many times have we heard people just flat out go ballistic in talking about, if God was active, where is he when now that children are dying? Where is he Now that young black men are dying. Where is he? Because all of this is going on. I'll tell you just where he is. He is always where he has been. But now the issue is really this. Watch this, brothers and sisters. Watch this. The issue really does become not what he did then. The issue is how he wants to use you now. We keep looking at what happened for other people. You need to know God wants to use you right now. Stop thinking that God wants to use someone else. God wants to use you right now. Boy, this is amazing. We get so stuck on what other folk are doing to us that we miss what we must do for ourselves. I don't disagree that a lot of the ugliness that we experience in America is a byproduct of slavery. I absolutely agree with it, 100%. I believe it has created fear in us so much. Come on here. That now young black men and young black women who are murdering each other are now preying on each other because of the fears that that has created. And the fears that have been created are also these fears. Watch this. That those in the faith community now sit at home, scared to go outside, preach Pastor Lindsay, because the murder rate across the country, not just in Kansas City, don't you think that this is just a Kansas City issue? Are so afraid and will do nothing. Don't you dare think that God doesn't know your fears. But I'm talking to some young man, some young woman. I'm talking to some middle-aged man, some middle-aged woman. I'm talking to some older gentleman and some older woman, older lady. This is the moment that really God called you to. You think that this moment is about the pandemic. You think that this moment is about all this other stuff. No! You are a mighty man. You are a mighty woman of valor. You just don't know what's in you because the fear and the pain of what's been created around you has robbed you of the power and the dignity to embrace the who you are. Brothers and sisters, I believe it with everything that I am that God created me for this moment. That God created you for this moment. That there was something in eternity that knew this moment was going to be here. And God dropped you in the planet for this moment, for this reason. Don't you ever allow your fears to rob you and keep you from making a difference. We let our religiosity keep us from trusting the word of God. We allow what other folk think about us keep us from honoring God. We allow the past formations of what we thought the church was to rob us of the dignity of how God shows up in us in peculiar spaces, in peculiar ways. That's why this text is important. Because this young man said, I'm the least of. I don't have it all worked out. But God tells him, no, you're right where I need you to be. In a space you weren't meant to be in or you thought you weren't meant to be in. Creating a necessary service in spaces that you weren't meant to do that in. Come on in here, y'all. Walk with me for just a couple of more minutes and I'll be done. Some of you right now feel cooped up in the space. Now you better be thinking and dreaming and trusting God. looking for ways to honor him, looking for ways to make a difference, believing that God is in the space in that apartment that you're in right now, that God is in the space of the house that you're in right now, that God is in the space of the car that you're in. Come on here. And that he is affirming and he will reaffirm who you are based on what he needs from you. Stop worrying about what other folk want from you. Start thanking God for what God wants to work in you. Let me hit 3 points, and I'm going to hit three central parts to why this text is important and how God wants to move you beyond your limits into the place that he wants, and how you know that God is active in the affairs and God is moving in your affairs right now. The first is this. Write this down. The first is this. The fact that God withheld and withholds his wrath, that it could be worse than what it is right now. Get this. It could be worse than what it is right now. What Satan means for evil, that God really means it for good. Don't you think that this moment that we're in, that God doesn't mean this for his glory and his good? This moment that we're in is absolutely a God moment, that God is ultimately going to exploit and is exploiting to his glory and to his good. Don't you ever think that God is not active just because stuff goes wrong? No, even when things go wrong, it could have been worse. So God uses moments to restrain evil from his people so that his people see things in a different light. That's what's happening in this text, brothers and sisters. That God wanted this young man to see his mission, his call, and his world in a different light. How many young men and women that we know, old men and old women that we know, who allow the ugliness of life to reduce them to the ugliness of life, versus how God can use the ugliness of life to elevate us to a place to honor him, to glorify him, and to make a difference in the world to his glory. Stop allowing the moments to frame you and allow the glory of God to frame you. Don't shrink. Don't allow the moments to shrink you. Don't allow the moments to make you what the moments want you to be, but allow God to speak in the moments. This is really important, especially coming out of this book, because remember, this is in a book that is boring, and the lessons are over and over and over, that Israel did wrong or Israel did evil in the sight of God. In the first chapter, in the 11th verse, he says the same thing. In the second chapter and the 7th verse, he says the same thing. In the second chapter and the 12th verse, he says the same thing. In the 4th chapter and the first verse, he says the same thing. And in the 6th chapter and the first verse, it talks about how Israel did evil, but it also speaks of how God delivered them. Brothers and sisters, I know there are times you don't measure up. There are times that you don't hit the mark, and it may happen over and over and over. But don't you dare think that God is not there and that God is not going to use that to his glory. Allow even your fragileness and your repeated bad decisions, allow God to begin to shift it. Allow God to begin to speak in it. Know that God is speaking in it to his glory. So that's one of the lessons that I want you to get on this. The next lesson I want you to get is that in the midst of it all, that God's mercy is still there. Get this. This was a young man who was afraid. The nation he was going to be the means by which God delivers them had forsaken God. But God is so merciful that he gives one more chance. One more time. Get the, remember, this wasn't one time Israel was forgiven. This is a whole book that shares how God continued to show up for them, that God continued to make a way for them. He let them pay the penalty of their sins, but he never left them. He never left them. I'm talking to somebody in here. You need to know that you are going to pay for the dishonor of God, but don't you ever think that God is going to leave you, because that's what a father does to a child who he really loves. He will let them make their own decisions, experience their own loss, because that's how you mature. That's how you become what God wants you to. But he will never leave them. He will never leave them. How many of us have gotten older and we say, man, the older our parents get, the more they forgive. They wasn't that forgiving when we were younger. Because they wanted to make sure that we learn how to pay the price for bad decisions. And that life is not easy. But the older we got, even when we made decisions that may have even broken us and fractured us even more, that one place you could always go. Come on, y'all. I'm having fun with this today. The one place I could always go back, I could go home to mama and daddy. Israel could always knew that they could always go back to God, and God would always make provision for them. I'm so glad that we're not, because how many times have people done things to us, and instead of being forgiving, that we were indicting the people. Matter of fact, we'd even tell them, if you see me coming, cross the street. Because you let me down, don't say another word. Lose my number. But brothers and sisters, because of God's mercy, he never tells us to cross the street. He never says, lose my number. He always gives invitation to him. Then the last point, y'all. That God was rich in bringing people that will always fulfill his call. Get that. Get this. Don't you ever think, this is how amazing God is. He will never miss the opportunity to bring people into your life. He finds this boy in the backwoods. He finds this boy in the most unproductive and the weakest of the tribes. He finds this boy who has self issues, and he pulls him out of obscurity. And this boy becomes the means of the nation's deliverance. Oh my goodness, brothers and sisters. That's why you need to thank God for people he brings into your life to help you. You know, our arrogance does not allow us to appreciate people. But brothers and sisters, you better learn how to appreciate people. Let me show you what I'm talking about, and I'm done after this. There have been times that I've been lower than low, that I didn't think I was given, that I wasn't worthy. But it's in those moments that God sent people like James Williams, Lee Dostin, Charles Washington, Marge Williams, Andrea Hendricks, James Tippin, Bernard Baggett, and a host of other people into the life of our church that affirmed the work of God, that they in many ways were deliverance, that God brought opportunity and change and salvation, not just in that older group, but even in some of the younger voices that are emerging, because now they come at a time when change is needed. And change happens. But just know that you're not on in this thing alone, that God is always sending people like he sent to Egypt. Just like he sent Moses, just like he sent Gideon, and just like he sent Jesus, who will step into your context and help you through the storms that you've been in. Let's pray. God, we bless you. I thank you for all of those that are watching this. God, right now, as doubtful as they may be in their spirit, through the work of your Son, through the power of your Spirit, speak power into them. That God, they would accept you as Lord through the work of your Son, but also be conduits of change in a hurting and fragile world. God bless you and keep you is our prayer. Bless the Lord. This is the first Sunday. And this is the Sunday that we share in the Lord's Supper. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. As often as you do it, you do show forth my death, burial, and resurrection. Doesn't matter if you do it daily. Doesn't matter if you do it weekly. As long as you observe and you remember the work of Jesus on the cross in the deliverance of mankind. Won't you join me as we prepare to take the Lord's Supper? And when they were set, Jesus sent two of his disciples into the city. Said, there you'll find a man. Tell him that the master has need of his chamber. And when they entered, they prayed. Let's pray. God, again, we thank you for this moment. Let us never forget the price that you paid through the shed blood of your Son, that we might have eternal life. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Then they took the bread and they broke it. The bread represents the body of Christ that was broken on Calvary's hill. Let us commune together. Then they took the wine and they passed it. The wine represents his shed blood. For in Leviticus, it tells us without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission to sin. Let us commune together, knowing that there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein. Sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilt and shame. We thank you for sharing in this first Sunday service with us and sharing in this communion service with us. God bless you and keep you as our prayer. Have a wonderful day in the Lord. Now we're going to turn you back into the hands of our staff.
Our Concord is that portion of the service where we're able to give back to God. So please get your offering ready. And remember, you can give a bunch of different ways. You can give via text message now. You can give via Cash App. You can give on the website at seafordhope.org. Or you can just mail in a check and give your offering that way. But whatever way you do it, long as you do it as a cheerful giver, that's all that matters. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you so much today for blessing us the way that you have. Thank you for providing for us the way that you have. Thank you for food on our table and clothes on our back, God. Even in the midst of a pandemic, God, you have been good. Now, God, as you take these gifts, use them to build your kingdom and your kingdom alone. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much, Concord, and we'll see you next week.